Welcome to this session about FreeRTOS on STM32 devices. Within this session, we'll discuss about FreeRTOS and its usage within STM32 devices using STM32CubeMX application. We will start from the short discussion about the operating system. What is the operating system? What are the main components of it? Then we will switch to the basic features of FreeRTOS. The next point would be the discussion about APIs used within the FreeRTOS. We will shortly discuss FreeRTOS API as native one. And then we will switch into CMC size API, which is proposed by ARM and which is an additional layer on top of FreeRTOS API. Within STM32CubeMX and our examples, which are available for all STM32 devices, we are using CMC's OS API layer. This is why we will focus more on this part within this session. The next part would be STM32CubeMX and its usage to generate the code with FreeRTOS on it. Then we'll discuss shortly the configuration parameters available for the FreeRTOS, and a bit longer part would be about the memory allocation schemes and memory allocation techniques used within the FreeRTOS. Then we will slightly go to discuss the main components of FreeRTOS, starting from scheduler. Then we will switch to tasks. Next point would be the discussion about the communication between the tasks. So we will touch the queues, semaphores, signals. The next point would be about the resource management. And then we'll switch into the mutexes, software timers. And after all those main components of the operating systems, we will focus a bit on hooks, stack overflow protection, and other advanced topics which are related to FreeRTOS. We will demonstrate to you the main components about the debugging, which are available within two toolchains, IR and GCC, based on Atolic TrueStudio example. And we'll discuss low power support, which is implemented within the FreeRTOS. At the end, you will see some basic information about the footprint of FreeRTOS and its comparison with other operating systems for embedded application without MMU.
Let's begin with the FreeRTOS and what it is about. In general, we will speak about what the FreeRTOS is as an operating system. We'll describe basic features, the two APIs that you can use to access its functions, linkage with the STM32CubeMX, and we'll have a couple of examples how to work with that and some live demonstration. We will speak about the setup of the FreeRTOS, how you can add or exclude features to save memory space. We will speak about memory allocation. This is a very important topic because you need to give some memory to different tasks. We will speak about how the scheduler works, how it gives time to different tasks. And we'll speak about the communication between the tasks, what a task is and what it is not, how the FreeRTOS manages its resources. And we'll speak about other items or objects that it supports. There is as well a chapter about advanced topics like implementing different safety hooks and functions that can report stack violation, memory exhaustion, and so on. We'll speak about debugging and support in different tools, and as well about the loper, which means that the FreeRTOS can give you some free time where the microcontroller does need to tick and does need to be alive to save typically the battery lifetime. And we will as well speak about the footprint in terms of flash and RAM size. So, a question to you, what is an operating system? What do you expect from an operating system? A simultaneous running of the tasks, implementing different modules, hardware resources management, interrupt and scheduling of the tasks. All this the operating systems should handle. However, now let's focus on a microcontroller. A thing running, for example, at 72 megahertz, having one single core and doing everything it can to manage your application. So a question, can a single core of Cortex-M4, for example, execute tasks in parallel? No, it can't. There is a one core, one execution pipeline for instruction. So it always will execute one instruction at a time, which means that it can switch between the tasks very quickly, but it can't execute them truly in parallel. So it's from the user perspective that they run in parallel because they, for example, switch every millisecond or faster, and at that moment, you as a user have the feeling of the parallel execution, but for the microcontroller, it's a heavy job of doing part of your task, switch to another one, do another task, switch to another one, do it, switch to another one, check if it is synchronized and waiting for a good thing and then coming back to the first one. So it's always doing a part of the job and coming to another job. The FreeRTOS can't be compared to something like a Windows because it's a tiny scheduler, it's a tiny thing to switch the tasks and manage synchronization between them. It's nothing that would contain peripheral drivers. It's nothing that would give you for free networking. So if you want to implement something big, it gives you the tools to create it, but it doesn't give you all the ecosystem integrated inside just like it is. So it needs a little bit of work. In the best case, clicking on I want the Ethernet stack in CubeMX and let it generate your code. So this is the minimum you need to do to have a working communication stack on top. But the FreeRTOS itself is not responsible for the connectivity. So the operating system is something that takes care about the environment where your applications are running. Same definition is valid for the FreeRTOS, but you can't expect a really big implementation, especially if you run on small microcontrollers and you on top expect, for example, a low current consumption. So, a question, what is a task, is explained on the slide. You can see that in terms of the definition on a microcontroller, it's a C function. The C function typically has got some initialization code, and then it has got a never-ending loop. In this never-ending loop, your task or mini application should be executed, and it should manage its communication and lifetime. It should as well manage its own timing. This mini program or mini application has as well associated its own stack, a place where it can place local variables and, for example, return address and context when it gets into the interrupt or into subfunctions. So each of the mini applications has its own stack defined in the memory. And it has as well a priority. The priority can be changed dynamically, so you can increase it and decrease it in the application lifetime. But it has a very big meaning when the core of the FreeRTOS schedules which task will operate next. So the whole idea behind the FreeRTOS is to give you a time slice. This is a time that the microcontroller spends executing your task. And when its time slice elapses, for example, after a millisecond of periodical interrupt, the scheduler will take the list of the running tasks and it will look which one has currently the highest priority. And then it will switch to this one and execute it maybe for another millisecond. And then it will again enter this switching process and it will check, hey, is there another task that is alive that has highest priority than this one? And if yes, bingo, we'll switch to it and we will execute it. So this is the way how the FreeRTOS, or typically any other RTOS, takes care about task switching. You'll later see that there exists a preemptive task switching and cooperative task switching. This has quite a big impact on the design of your application, so you will see later in detail. Further, each of the tasks can operate in four different states. The first one is when it is created, it becomes ready. What that means? Ready means that such task is able to be executed. So the scheduler can pick it up and it can start execution. However, when I have got a task with a higher priority, I can put this task aside and it can be as well put back to ready state. So it comes from ready to running and back from running to ready. And that's the decision of the scheduler which task will execute. There is one more possibility when the task asks for a resource that is not available. It can be data in the queue, it can be a mutex, it can be waiting for a semaphore or for a signal. So if such resource is not available, the task can become blocked. At that moment, the scheduler will remember that the task waits for something and it will put in a specific queue, in a specific list, telling that it's blocked and it waits for a resource. And when the resource becomes available, like somebody releases the mutex, or you get a semaphore, or you send a message to this task, the kernel will evaluate it. It will notice that this task received the message. It will unblock it and it can move it back to the ready state. And if this task currently, when it's unblocked, has the highest priority, it will come back to the running state immediately. Additionally, you can force the task to a suspended state where it's removed from the scheduling process and it doesn't consume any CPU time. It has one advantage. You don't bother with this task. You don't waste the time evaluating its priority. So it's very effective when you simply need to remove this task and don't care about it. Still, it's there. You have it at hand. You don't need to recreate it. You can execute it anytime you want when you remove it from the suspended state. These are the main states that you can expect from any of your mini tasks or mini applications. The transition between all these comes in terms of API calls to the kernel or by the scheduler itself. So you can, for example, force yourself from the running state to the ready. If you call the function OS yield, you just give up the CPU time and you let the scheduler select another task if it is available. So you get, for example, into the blocked state if you wait for some time. You can say, okay, now I'm toggling the LED. So let's put it, let's put the task into the blocked state by calling a delay function. So you want to toggle the LED every 200 milliseconds. So your function will look like LED toggle and OS delay 200 milliseconds. Then the task will be automatically put into the blocked state for 200 milliseconds, and the scheduler will put it back to ready after the 200 milliseconds elapse. So it gives you the chance for timing the task execution. Now, when you know how the tasks change their lifetime and how they cooperate through the scheduler, you probably should understand that if you have already a CPU running at 100% of your time in a bare metal application, putting a FreeRTOS may not be a big help for you. Because performance-wise, you will spend approximately 0.1-0.5% of the time in task switching. But FreeRTOS can help you in simplifying your application, in splitting it into much more simple tasks, but it will not help you to accelerate it. Especially if you already use all the microcontroller time and you will put the FreeRTOS on top of this. Priority of the tasks. It will help you in managing the communication between them, but it will not increase the performance. Of course, if you have functions that, for example, spend too much time by synchronization of the data between the tasks, FreeRTOS can be more effective. If you need to wait for a given resource, then, okay, for example, switching in the state machine, whether it will go this way or this way, the FreeRTOS can give you a little bit more performance. But overall, it will not increase the performance. One more thing, the task should never end. If you leave the task function, you crash the FreeRTOS. That's because it doesn't have any return address. It doesn't know where to return. And next thing, what you should expect from the FreeRTOS is its scheduler. This is a background part of code that takes care about switching between the tasks. So the scheduler is a thing that gets called by different API functions at the end of interrupts, and whenever you, for example, call a blocking functions. So it's activated, and when it's activated, it decides what other task should be running. It can decide that it will return back to the original task if it's the only one with the highest priority. But if by internal or external API calls, another task became ready and it gets higher priority than the current one, then the scheduler will choose the task with the higher priority. It's always about priority. And if you have two or more tasks with the same priority, then it will move in a round robin. So if I have got three tasks with the same priority and task number one finishes, then it will look into the task number two. And if task number two finishes, it will look in task number three. And when three is finished, then it will look again in task number one. But if you have a task number five with higher priority, it will always jump to task number five if five is ready. Now, what is a differentiation between a preemptive and cooperative mode? This is a very important thing to understand. And This is as well about fine-tuning your application. In preemptive mode, if a task gets a higher priority and becomes ready, it is immediately switched over. So you can see here that if task number two is awakened, or if the scheduler gets, for example, a time-based tick, it can immediately jump to the task number two if it has a higher priority than task number one. So in preemptive mode, the task switching happens immediately when the kernel knows it, when it recognizes it. And it can be on the function call, it can be on the periodical interrupt on the time base, or from interrupts by sending signals, messages, or other synchronization objects. So in a preemption, the task switching happens anytime in your application lifetime. The cooperative mode is different. In cooperative mode, the kernel will not switch immediately, but it will switch only when the original task gave up its time by getting into the blocked state. So in cooperative, you always must create functions by the way of calling OS delay, OS yield, or waiting for some synchronization object. Otherwise, even if the task one has a lower priority than task two, the task one, if it never gives up CPU time, it will never switch to task two. So even if task two has a higher priority, it must wait until task one finishes its job. The truth is that the preemptive gives you a feeling of faster responsiveness. But on the other side, I could say that the preemptive mode is a little bit less efficient, because the task switching takes some time. And additionally, if you need to synchronize the tasks, for example, their timing, it can be a little bit more difficult to handle. While in cooperative mode, if you are waiting for something, if you are stuck in a task that, for example, does an FFT calculation, then you are stuck for this time. But the FFT is finished as one block, and you have got the result in the shortest possible time. So when I do my applications, I prefer the cooperative, because it seems to me to be a little bit more stable. I can tell you that I've got some demo application created that runs approximately 22 tasks. And in the cooperative mode, it works. If I switch it to the preemptive, it doesn't crash, but doesn't work well. So you have to test it. You have to think well how you design the application. Further, let's talk about the heap of the operating system. You already know that when you have a task, it contains a stack. Stack is part of memory where it places its local variables and context when it jumps to subfunctions or interrupts. However, these stacks need to be placed in a RAM memory and managed. And when you create a new task, its stack has to be dynamically allocated. And when you kill the task, it can be deallocated. Additionally, a lot of other objects, or effectively all RTOS objects, need some part of the memory that can be allocated dynamically. This allocation happens on a chunk of memory that's managed globally by the FreeRTOS in the heap. So FreeRTOS has its own heap management. And we will see later which methods can be used for the heap management. But right now, you can notice what the heap contains. So when it's created, it's initialized during initialization of the FreeRTOS. And then FreeRTOS takes care about putting different objects and allocating the memory in the heap to these objects. So the first part of the heap is dedicated for the main application, but it doesn't need to be used. It can be used, for example, for printf function and some other RTLC functions, but it's not used by FreeRTOS itself. FreeRTOS then defines a block of memory. Normally it can be a variable that you define as a static variable with some size. It can be as well placed anywhere in the memory, SDRAM, internal SRAM, external SRAM, and so on. But that's what the FreeRTOS will take care of in terms of its content and allocation. And when you look at the global RAM here that we have, we still need to allocate a stack for the interrupts and for the main application before we start and jump the scheduler. So if we look into the heap, you can see that the heap contains the data for the tasks that we define. So when I create a task A, I am creating a block of memory in the heap of the FreeRTOS that belongs to this task. And it consists of two parts. The first one is the task control block. This is a chunk of memory that describes the task. It tells to the scheduler where the task resides in the memory. It gives a snapshot of the CPU registers stored in this block. It contains the information of where the allocation of the stack for this task is. And it gives all the states, like whether task is ready, whether it's waiting for something. So all this information is stored in the task control block. And the second part of the task allocated memory is its stack. So when you create a task, it creates the TCB and the stack. And when it launches the task, it puts the top of the stack to the top of the area that it allocated in the heap. The advantage, each task can work as an independent mini application with its own dedicated memory, which is a stack of the task. Now, what happens when you create a second task? When you create a task B, the RTOS again creates or takes part of the memory from its heap, and it creates its own TCB and its own stack for the task B. And now what happens when the scheduler switches from task A to task B? Who will decide how big stack you allocate to the task, right? You as a programmer. How you can do it? When you compile your application, the compiler and linker can give you a call tree with a depth of the stack, estimated depth of the stack. So you can look in the map file or in the file that lists the call tree, and you can try to deduct. Unfortunately, you have to count for recursive functions, and then you don't know how deep stack you will need. So unfortunately, it's you. Of course, you can help yourself by this call tree. But another possibility is when you debug your application, you can simply give it a big stack. So as much memory as you can. And when you run your application and you test it in different scenarios, in different corner cases, the stack has got, when it's created, it has got a special pattern written into it. So the FreeRTOS is able to check periodically and at the moment of switching to this task, how much of the stack was overwritten. So it checks from the bottom of the stack and goes upwards and looks how much dead beef is in there. And it gives you this amount in the task description. So in runtime, you can observe how much stack is used for a given task. And if you see there is too much unnecessary space, you can reduce it when you create a new version of your application. So by this, you can adapt the stack size. And additionally, when a task switcher recognizes that the stack was corrupted, which means that even the bottom safety part was overwritten, it will give you, or it can give you, a hook that there was a stack overflow. So the FreeRTOS can help you in debugging such situation by telling you how much stack is used or whether the stack overflow happened. So if you have stack overflow, you should increase the stack size. But on the other side, if you see that only small part of the stack is used, you can reduce it. Cortex-M itself doesn't have any means of preventing the application from overflowing your stack. There is nothing in the core. On the other side, it has got a memory protection unit. So if you use the FreeRTOS-MPU extension, you can define for each task how big stack it has, and when you switch to it, the MPU can define regions where the task is accessible in the memory, and if it guards the stack and it runs out of the stack, you get a memory protection exception. So it's possible, but the -MPU is a specific port of the FreeRTOS. And it has got some support when the task creation is done. But you as well need to help yourself, because it doesn't know where you have got, for example, global variables. So you need to split among the 8 regions you have. 4 of them are user selectable and 4 of them are selectable by the FreeRTOS. So it can help you in this matter. But natively, without the MPU extension, this is not used, and only when you do the task switch you can recognize what happens with the stack. So I will come back to the question, what defines a context of your task in a run state when it's executed on the core. So if you do a task switch, the scheduler will take these 17 registers, it will put them in the TCB task control block, and then it will load the same 17 registers, R0 to R15 plus the program status register, from the task control block of the other task. It will simply load the registers, it will do the interrupt return, and a second task is running. That simple it is. So whenever you get a task switch, the context switcher takes these registers, puts them in the appropriate TCB, marks the task as ready or blocked, depending, and it chooses another task, loads its own registers, and that's done. New task is running. This, however, is valid only under one condition. You don't use a floating point unit. If you use a floating point unit, there is another set of registers that need to be saved, another 17 registers. So if you use Cortex-M4, the FreeRTOS will require that you enable the support for a floating point unit, and it will as well deal with the floating point registers on top of the standard ones. So you need to be careful whether you enable the floating point unit or let it disabled. Additionally, when all the tasks are created and you create a new object like a Q1 in this example, it's as well put on your heap. So it resides in the same heap, and you can see that by defining other objects, especially queues that can hold quite a lot of information, the amount of heap in your application can be quite quickly exhausted. So I give you one set hint. You will always fight for your memory, especially for RAM. There is always lack of RAM for the full extent of your application. So be careful how much stack you give to your tasks and try to use as low amount as possible, but still a reliable amount. Do you have any idea how you can save some memory if you really have a lack of heap? For example, many communication tasks, a graphical task, and so on. I had an application that needed a lot of memory, but not at the same time. So I was operating with graphics, but once the graphical object was created, I didn't need this memory. Then I needed memory for a communication task. Again, dynamically allocated and deallocated quite quickly. So if I would do this in separate tasks, if I would need this memory, each of the tasks would need to have a very big stack. So instead of that, I decided to create one super task that received commands from different tasks, and it used one common stack that was shared between the tasks. So there was a switch. If I get this command, please use the memory this way, and when you are finished, release it. When you get this command, again, use your own stack this way, and then release it. So by this way, I was able to share the memory in time, still giving many different tasks the chance to operate with a big chunk of memory. So this way I was able to save my application until I came to another way of memory allocation, but you will see it later. Okay, let's speak a little bit more in detail about the FreeRTOS. When you look at the market of the RTOSs, you will find out that there are many tens of different RTOS flavors. There are old ones like MicroCOS2, MicroCOS3. There are RTOSs made by specific manufacturers or tool developers like CircleOS from Resonance or RTX from Kyle. There are different OSs that come public like EmbedOS, and FreeRTOS is quite an old one, but the advantage is it is still developed. It was created by Richard Berry, and he still moderates the forum about it. It was maintained by a company, Realtime Engineers Limited, in England, and it has as well different flavors in terms of commercial usage and safety certifications. So you can get FreeRTOS free of charge. It has got a very relaxed license, so I think you can use it even in closed projects. However, if you need a really commercial support, you can opt for the open RTOS where you pay for the support to the real-time engineers, and you get the support, you get the response from the team who develops that. There is as well a safe RTOS, which is one blend of the FreeRTOS with a safety certification. I don't know which exactly, but you can review it on the web. The documentation and the source codes are available on freertos.org, and the forum is as well available here. However, recently the FreeRTOS was acquired by Amazon. Good news is they want to invest in FreeRTOS, and they are still working on that. Recently they put it on the public GitHub, and they split the development to standard FreeRTOS and the two flavors, and they as well create on top a FreeRTOS Plus, which is a platform for different drivers like networking, TCP/IP, memory management, I/O, and I think file system. You can get this as a package, plus you can get as well additional packages for testing different scenarios, test cases, and specific peripheral drivers. Good news is it's still developed and maintained. Main features of this blend of the RTOS is that it can work in both preemptive or cooperative real-time kernel. This is a compile option, so you have to choose before you compile, and then when you compile it's fixed. Then it can be as low as 10 kilobytes in flash and just a few hundreds of bytes in RAM. But then it scales with number of features that you want to add, and the RAM rises with an amount of tasks that you create. If you want to support a low power modes, so if your application needs to sleep, the FreeRTOS supports a tickless mode. This gives you the feature of stopping the system timer and keeping the microcontroller, for example, in a stop or sleep mode until some external event wakes up the microcontroller. So it can be an event from the real-time clock, but it can be as well incoming communication, button press, and so on. But in the meantime, there is no periodic interrupt, so the time base is stopped and the microcontroller doesn't need to consume anything dynamic. As a good operating system should do, it gives you a means for inter-task communication and for synchronization of different hardwares. So, it gives you queues for messages where you can pass a message from a task to another task or from an interrupt to the task. It gives you a binary and counting semaphores that allow to guard a limited pool of resources. Mutexes that allow to synchronize or give an exclusive access to one specific resource. And there is as well a very interesting thing like events or group events, where several different situations have to occur either serially or in parallel. And when all of them or just one of them happens, the task can be awakened, waiting on these flags. Plus, the management of these events is quite flexible, because you don't need to put the messages only in the FIFO manner, but you can as well place the messages at the top of the queue, and you can look in the queue, you can count the messages. So it's very flexible in which order you send and receive the events. Additionally, if you need a little bit more precise scheduling of different asynchronous actions, you can use software timers where you can plan ahead. For example, in 10 seconds I want to execute a thing. So you register a callback function and the timeout in the software timer mechanism. And after 10 seconds from now, the FreeRTOS will launch your function. It will jump to the callback that you provided, and it will execute the code that you preset. Further, the FreeRTOS is equipped or written with a lot of macros that mark entry and exit to different functions. So if you put a tracing messages or tracing management into these macros, you can see in the trace record every entry into the task, every exit from the task, memory allocations, faults, and a lot of other things. So it gives you quite a nice way of debugging. And if you are able to collect this information, for example, over serial line with a printf style or with a memory record or something else, trace recorder, like for example, Kyle offers, you have got quite a nice way of seeing what happens inside your microcontroller. On top of the standard set of functions or application interface, API, the FreeRTOS was chosen as one of the targets for the standardization based on the CMC's RTOS API from ARM. So FreeRTOS, RTX, and probably some other RTOSs have now the same interface, which means if you want to port from one RTOS to the other, it's very easy because the interface from the application layer is still the same. What the FreeRTOS requires from you when you implement it on a microcontroller? It's not much, but it's still enough to be able to do all the tasks that you expect from the FreeRTOS. So when you implement the FreeRTOS, it will allocate the system timer. You can it will use the system timer as a periodic time base. Typically, you can set up your own frequency of the time base, but the shortest time you could use for the time base is defined as 1 millisecond. It doesn't allow you to go faster, but you can define 2, 5, 10 milliseconds. So the granularity is on you, but the resolution is 1 millisecond. So system timer SysTick is hooked to SysTick interrupt. So you need to hook or let the RTOS take the SysTick interrupt. Further, it gets access to the stack pointers, MSP, so main stack pointer, and program stack pointer. The MSP is used for the interrupts and the scheduler. And it's used during the task switch. However, the PSP, program stack pointer, is used for the tasks to point to their local stacks. Which means if you run your task, it uses its own dedicated pointer to the stack and it moves with that. However, when you jump into the scheduler uses its own separate stack pointed by the main stack pointer. So they are independent, they don't cross each other, and that has got a safety benefit. Further, it takes another interrupt vectors. It takes the system service call to get the priority when you call different API functions. So if you want something from the RTOS, you have to switch from the thread mode to the interrupt mode so that all RTOS functions occur in the interrupt. This has one benefit because FreeRTOS runs in a dual stack model where it has separated privileges for the tasks and for the kernel. And by calling the SVC function, you are giving it all the privileges for the kernel, and the FreeRTOS takes care about all the functionality with high privilege. That's why all the functions are running in the interrupts. Further, it has got a hook on the pendable system service call, which is an interrupt used for switching the context. This is an asynchronous interrupt, typically with a low priority, that is switched on by setting a flag in the NVIC controller register. So when you want to do a context switch, you set this flag, it will launch the interrupt, and this will do the context switch. The advantage is that you can trigger the context switch, for example, at the end of the standard interrupt routines. So if you have an interrupt from UART, where you send this new data to the queue, you typically call or put the data in the queue in this interrupt, and then it will trigger the pendable system call, so that when the UART interrupt finishes, the pendable system call will be launched just afterwards. So it's very effective, uses tail chaining, and it allows you to do more stuff and process the context switch just once at the end of the interrupts. And it takes the sysctl. The flash memory it needs for the kernel depends on how many features you want to implement. You can strip all of them away, so you can remove mutexes, counting semaphores, timers. You can decide which memory management you will use, and this all will add to the complexity and size of the kernel. So if you want a really minimal one, you will just probably use queues and mutexes and nothing more. But if you want a full-featured FreeRTOS kernel, it will be a little bit bigger. In terms of RAM, it will allocate approximately half kilobyte plus everything you give to the heap. Using the system service call, it's launched by an instruction where the instruction holds the number of the request. Such mechanism is typically used in the RTX from Kyle. FreeRTOS doesn't use it that much, so we can probably skip it. The pended or pendable system call interrupt is the one that takes care about the context switch, and it can be launched by this line of code. One thing the pendable system call doesn't execute immediately, but only when all higher priority interrupts are finished. The system service call instruction is executed immediately, while pendable system call is pendable, so it means it can wait. Speaking about the system timer, it's always allocated by the FreeRTOS. When you operate with the STM32 and with the hardware abstraction layer, the hardware abstraction layer needs as well a time base. When you don't use the FreeRTOS, sysctl is used as the time base. However, if you activate a FreeRTOS, the CubeMX will warn you that you need to use a different time base for the HAL. It has a very good meaning, because if you combine several different tasks and you would wait for the same interrupt from the sysctl to elapse a timeout and to finish the context switch, you would create a code lock and you wouldn't be able to recover. So having the sysctl used for both HAL time base and the FreeRTOS time base is quite a dangerous thing. So we don't recommend it, and that's why we offer another timers as a time base for the HAL. So please use it. Typically, if you choose in the sys section of the CubeMX the time base for the HAL as a timer 6 or 7, which don't have much other usage, you do the best thing. Because timers 6 and 7 are very small in implementation and can give you only a periodic interrupt. apart from the synchronization of the DACs. Normally, when you have a CubeMX open and you click on the FreeRTOS, it gives you an option, a chapter sys, like system, that you can choose a time base from a list of timers. So it can be a SysTick, it's not recommended, but it can be as well any other timer. If you choose the timer, then it will be grayed out, so you can't use it for any other purpose, but it will be then automatically initialized by the init code, and it will be used as a time base for HAL. When we look at the file structure of the FreeRTOS, you can find different files for different functionality. So each functionality has its own implementation in separate source and header files. These can be included by a configuration of the FreeRTOS. So if you don't use timers, you can completely strip them off, and the timers.c file won't be included and timers header file won't be included. So the API will not be present. And it's valid for most of the things. There are some common ones, but there are as well things that don't need to be implemented. One remark, there exist common functions or common source files, but then there exist as well files that relate to different vendors. So they are vendor specific, and among those you will find the port that's vendor specific, and you will as well find for user selection a list of a heap underscore 1 to 5 files where you should always choose just one of them into the implementation. This will bring up the functions for allocation and deallocation of the memory in the heap by different functionalities. So for example, heap 1 is only a static allocation, while heap 5 is an allocation in many different areas. So it can allocate in several split parts of the memory.